Today it's all about melodic techno chords you need. That's today's video. Let's get into it right here and right now. Hey, what's up? I'm in the kitchen and thank you for checking out yet another video. Now, if this is your first time here, don't hesitate to click subscribe. You'll be updated whenever I upload a new video, but that is when you click the bell icon as well. You'll make sure to not miss out on anything. That's cool. I'd like to welcome Rickard Saez and Peter Mabry as my new patrons. They are following me on patreon.com/analogkitchen, where I'm actually building a mixer. If you follow this channel, you heard me talk about it. I do think there's a gap in between the club mixer and the studio mixer. So we're actually building, and you guys on Patreon are helping support that fact. Thanks for supporting. As well as the new subscribers, we are growing in numbers. We're building a community. I do think it's cool. So welcome all you new gangs to my channel. That Erica Sin's Acid Box 3 video, believe me, it's coming. I'm working on it. I know I've been a bit slack, but there's so much stuff that's going on with the moving of the studio, which is still not completely done and everything. So please bear with me. It is coming. It is coming. I'm telling you, it is coming. Now, for a melodic techno chord, I will actually have to take you to a piano, which I've got like set up somewhere else, and show you when it comes to melodic techno. I am literally the best piano player in the whole wild universe. If you consider, I can only play one chord, which is the C minor chord. So obviously I'm going to show you on how I do that. Don't slack me. I'm just playing a little bit like that. No, let's get over there. We're over here at the piano and let's see what we can actually come up with. It's easy for me to just show you on a live set, but I think it's better if you just understand what the chord structure is going to be when I play it on a piano. Now, what I'll do, I'll play something in a C chord, which means it's not too complicated. You don't need to be a wizard, you don't need to have all the chord knowledge in your head, just follow along. What I'll basically do is I'll play a C, that's here, and I'll play a G, that's here, and this. Basically what is going to be played all the time, but the ground note or the bass note is going to determine how these are related to each other. So it can even go further when you play, adding this note here. That's basically how I set up a chord, and then obviously with delays and reverbs and everything, it's going to start to sound different. And you have to keep in mind that this will be played by the tetra, and this will be played by the Model D. So obviously this is going to be very rich in the bass note, so it's going to be dramatic, filling up the whole bottom end spectrum of your chord, and then the top notes on the chord are going to be played by different synthesizers. And then what I also see that's working on melodic techno is having an arpeggio of some sort, so something like that. Play them. Something like this or something. Now, why would you need those chords in the first place? Well, the thing is, sometimes, you know, you need to just add a little bit of melody to add drama to your tracks. I mean, to make beats it simple, and you know me, I'm all about making bass lines and creating just the funkiest bass lines ever. I really like to do that with bass synthesizers. So what we're going to do is see if we can get those synthesizers to really work in our favor. Mind you, most of the time, the synths that you will find when you're looking for outboard synths are monophonic synths. So there's a few that are polyphonic, and not all of the polys are analog, so there's a bit of a search going on if you need to find a synthesizer for your needs. Let's see if we can make those chords work, and let's see if we can really make a rocking track. Yeah, let's head over there. Making sure that I am actually recording, because oh my god, today I'm just now that looks good. It actually looks amazing. I can't believe that it, you know, sometimes you get those days that actually everything seems to be working. That's a deliberate way why I actually like to play music on the MPC. Because when I play piano, and in my years of making music, I just tend to play like things that are natural to me, but it starts to become predictable sometimes when you got it laid out and you play certain things. And I'm not the best piano player in the world, so what I play is usually what I always play. So with this, you have to actually combine drumming with playing, and I really like that fact. All right, so let's record the bass line that we played. The notes are, if I'm lengthening the notes on the Model D, it's this one, this one, this one, and this one. So obviously that is going to be my main foundation on top of the beats. Now the drums are playing this. Yeah, so let's record that. 2, 3, and. Here we go. Yeah, I'm liking this. See, now this bottom note is already giving you some sort of a dramatic feeling. You can really work a little bit on the sound. Detune one of the oscillators. Yeah, nice. Okay, now it comes time to add something on top of it. So the top layer of the synths we just played on the piano. I'm gonna play that with the Tetra. So I'm going to go over here on my Akai MPC Live, and on 12, track 12, as I told you, is the Tetra. See if so. Yeah, I'm liking this. Okay, I'm going to see if I'm going to record this, huh? Check it out, say. Let's correct that error on the end. I'm liking this. As you know that I rooted my Dave Smith through the octave track, I can now dramatize the chords. Moving on, let's play an arpeggio. It's going to be played by the Minitaur, so. Yeah. Okay, now for a bit of sound design. Now the Minitaur only plays three octaves, which means that it's not a lead kind of thing, because if you know the Taurus, if you know the Moog Taurus, that was a bass synthesizer that people played with their feet. Obviously this is a reissue of that thing, so it's not going to play high notes. So when you're listening to what it's playing right now, you hear that it's playing something. Let's put a little bit of effect on it. Let's not go overboard and wash it out, but something spacey is cool. Let's turn off the Model D here. We can really focus on the Minitaur, what it's playing. Because I want the sound to be a little bit more dramatic. I put some LFO on there. Nice. Now what I'll do, what I did is I'll open up the pitch on one of the oscillators. See, but instantly your track is going. Now let's add the Dave Smith. So the trick to these chords, is to actually see if you can play something which is rhythmical, or at least combine drums with melody. So on my Patreon page, someone was saying, I need to look up who it is, but I'm gonna put it in on the screen. Somebody said, like, do you really need chords or melodies? Do you need them? Well, that depends, you know. I mean, if you can want to combine the two, so that when you play a lot of melodic stuff and it doesn't really come across like you're playing like a symphony, if you play your chords in a rhythmical sense, so you approach it from a drum kind of approach, I think it works better for you than if you were to focus on having that thing just play like long chords, which is cool if you want to go that route, but you know, most of the time it's really hypnotizing people on the floor, and people like to dance and get more into some sort of an adrenaline thing, which drums invoke on people a little bit more than melodies, I would say, because melodies put something in a certain state of mind sometimes, and drums will just instantly get people's adrenaline up. And I do think that when you make dance music, especially if you want to combine two things together, it's cool to just combine it that way. So the piano that I played is playing the chords over on the Tetra like that. Dramatize it with long notes and shorter notes, and then add the bass line. Let me lower those highest because it's like razor blades. Now we go for that arpeggio, yeah? Shall we add a 303? That thing's staring at me. Let's see if we can get it to play something. I'm already in the same key. What I will do is I will put the thing in ride mode, which is here. And I will actually just, this is the thing what I like about the TB-03. When you play the notes, see, so this is my first note. And that first note, I will go like, ooh, doo, doo, doo. Stick it here. So that's the ground note of what I'm playing. Boo, boo. See where we are? I'm not so sure if I like this. What have I got? Let me listen. And then the last step, which is all the way over here, if I press and hold it, I can go all the way up to 16 steps, or I can just go into a polymetric mode where if I just stick it on 6 or 5, you'll get. Now what I will do to gel my chords that I already have together is lower the pitch by an octave, stick it on a square wave, put a little bit of resonance on it, a little bit of envelope modulation as well. Decay is okay, bit of delay. Now listen what happens if I'm going to play all these things together. Turn this off. Follow the TBL3. Listen what happens when it plays together with the... And turn it up a little bit. With the chords. I'm liking this. See, so everything is together. Let's add a little bit more cutoff frequency. But we're not going to tweak it like acid house, we're just going to keep it in the same spot. So those notes are playing. So when you can listen to this on a headphone or something, you know that you're actually widening the stereo field with the Tetra stereo. Let's add the Minitaur. Like so. So now we're starting to gel everything together. Baseline. Well, I sincerely hope that that was useful, you know. Don't be a stranger, click subscribe, hit the bell, you'll be notified whenever I upload a new video. So, as well as the equipment that I'm using is noted in the fold below. There's something else I really need to tell you. Also, be sure to look for this track on Bandcamp because it's going to be uploaded in the next coming days, I reckon. And if you want to support the fact that I'm building my own mixer for live musicians like you and me, let's see if we can make something work. So if you go over to my Patreon page, which is patreon.com/analogkitchen, that's where I'm actually talking about it, building it. I'm actually showing you guys what the process is in building my own mixer. It's really cool and very exciting project. Don't be a stranger, leave a comment, and I'll catch you in another video. Peace.